to order. This is the July 14th, 2014 CPDC meeting. Start with the disclaimer, it's my first meeting as chairman, so bear with me as I feel my way through the ropes. First order of business, public hearing for site plan review, 303 Salem Street, Cumberland Farms. And Nick, would you mind reading the public hereing notice?
Notice hereby given under section 4.3.3 of the Reading zoning bylaws, the Community Planning and Development Commission, CPDC, will hold a public hearing on Monday, July 14th, 2014 at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to hear the site plan review application from Cumberland Farms, Inc. for the property located at 303 Salem Street and 8 Torrey Street, Assessor's Map 23, lots 20 and 21. The applicant is proposing the construction of 9 new parking spaces, new dumpster recycle enclosure area, and new loading area. Other improvements include proposed lighting and landscaping. A copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Community Services Department in Town Hall Monday through Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m. Reading Community Planning and Development Commission.
Okay, so just review how the process works. So we'll ask town staff to just kind of open up, give an overview of the project, and then ask the applicant to provide an overview of your project as well. The board members will debate it. Actually, one more point. If you can keep your presentation to about 10 minutes, that would be appreciated. Then we'll open it up to debate and discussion, open it up for the public to make any comments, ask questions. Then we'll close the public hearing and continue down to review the forms and hopefully have them approved. So, Jean, if you kick us
Thank
off.
You. This is Cumberland Farms on Salem Street. It's the corner of Salem and Torrey Street. Most people probably know it by the fact that it's located next to REI. And this is a project that CPDC approved a few years ago for a new canopy and overall site improvements, as well as some improvements to the building. Now they're back in front of the board with an additional piece of land that they've purchased, some additional parking, relocated dumpster area, and some related landscaping. That's essentially the project.
Great, thank you. So who wants to start? Yeah, please, sir. Jump on in.
Good evening. For the record, my name is John Smolak with the firm of Smolak and Vaughn of North Andover, attorney for the applicant Cumberland Farms. With me this evening are Greg Avenia, our Garofalo Associates project engineer, Heather Montecup of Green & Peterson, our project traffic engineer is here as well, as Paul Wilson, our project manager with Cumberland Farms. As Gene has indicated, basically we're looking, Cumberland Farms is looking to obtain approval for basically site-related improvements as a follow-up to the board's review of this project back in 2012, which at that time was more building-related improvements and signage that were reviewed by the board. And since that time, Cumberland Farms actually leases both 303 Salem Street, which is the existing site that's approximately 3/4 acre in size. That includes the existing 3,600 square foot convenience store, as well as the pumps and dispensers on that site. In addition, the adjacent portion of the site is 8 Torrey Street, which is approximately a little over 3/4 acre in size. That includes an existing vacant single-family building. As a result of the review of the project, we determined that the 303 Salem portion of the site is entirely within the business B district. And based on our review, both principally with the planning office and as well as the engineering office, the zoning district boundary between the business and the single-family residential 15 runs right through basically the center of 8 Torrey Street. And as a result, we took a look at the zoning bylaws, which allow for the extension of this business district for an additional 30 feet into the area that's more restricted. And so as a result of the provisions under the zoning bylaw, were able to capture all of the proposed improvements within the Business B zoning district. And just by way of background, in terms of some of the other features on the site, you have an existing brook or riverfront area on this site that extends the 200-foot riverfront area almost entirely throughout the parcel. The as had been indicated by Gene, we're essentially constructing 9 additional parking spaces in this area, along with a new dumpster area and recyclables area, which includes a new loading area. We're slightly modifying the curb cut off of Torrey Street, and actually also adding additional landscaping and some lighting improvements as well. And so back in on April 30th, we met with the DRT, which provided additional feedback to us. And also, the project has been issued a wetlands order of conditions by the Conservation Commission. What I'd like to do is have Greg Avenia just walk you through quickly some of the changes that have occurred as a result of the DRT review, input from the engineering office, and the like. Greg?
My name is Greg Avenia. I'm a project manager, professional engineer with Garofalo Associates. Would it be possible to bring up the color graphic? Might be a little easier to point out.
Susanna, title graphic in the folder.
Okay.
That's the second one from the top.
Right, so this is the project site. I don't know if it shows up very well, but this is the existing residence at 8 Torrey Street. This is the property line between the two. Carmel Farms is on lot 21. The lot up here is lot 20. And above it, this is the Goddard School, Hardig, Walker Brook, Salem Street, and Torrey Street. And what we're proposing is to raise the existing residence at 8 Torrey Street. As John said, there'll be 9 new parking spaces. Everything has been designed to stay out of the 100-foot buffer for Hardig Brook, that this line right here. And based on the conversations that we've had at the DRT, the conversations we've had with the Conservation Commission, this area right here is presently really just the backyard of 8 Torrey Street. There's a lot of brush in there. There's a lot of invasive species. What we will be doing is clearing that out, replanting with more native species, blueberry bushes, and fencing it off. So effectively, it's going to be more of a protected habitat area, a natural wetland buffer. Part of that work would be there's existing cedar fence along the back of the Carmel Farms here. We would be extending that along to the fence for the Goddard School to really protect that area from any access. for stormwater management, we would be providing a lined sand filter that would treat any kind of water that comes into it. This area is pitched this way, and this area is pitched this way. So it's really just the drainage from the new parking spaces. But in the effort to be a good neighbor, there's an existing water quality structure right here that treats the water coming off of the Carmel Farm site. We're going to take that existing water quality unit out. We're going to put a new one in that has been tested to perform a lot better. Everything will be routed through that water quality unit before it makes it out to Walker Brook. There will also be significant plantings up here and plantings down here as well. Based on the comments that we received from the planning department and from the town engineer, the trees will be enlarged from a 2.5-inch caliper to a 3-inch caliper. There were a couple other changes that are going to be made. This area back here presently is about 16 feet wide. It's enlarged to 18 feet wide for fire access. there's a loading area that's delineated around the dumpster area, and that will just provide a place for trucks to pull off, get out of the way so they're not blocking traffic. And to make this more pedestrian accessible, there'll be a crosswalk leading up to the loading area, which can come across. There'll be a trash receptacle in the center here, and there is a handicap ramp, an accessible ramp, leading through all of it. And that's really the majority of the site.
And lastly, if we could have Heather Montecup and Freeman Peterson just discuss some of the traffic or circulation matters.
So for the record, I'm Heather Montecup with GPI, and we're the traffic engineers for the proposed project. they kind of summed up everything quite well, but just to note, there's 12 parking spaces on the site today. With the addition of 9, we'll have 22. And today, the dumpster is located right here. You can see the cutout. So it's right on top of this driveway, which makes, you know, deliveries, blockage of the driveway when the waste container is being changed over. So, as they said, adding 9 parking spaces, relocating the dumpster facility, providing a loading zone, providing pedestrian connectivity from the new spaces to the store. What I really want to talk about is on-site circulation. Today, if you've been out there, this is the existing curb line today. If you have vehicles lined up in these fueling positions, you'll see that it's very difficult to get around that. In fact, sometimes people need to back up and maneuver through the site another way. By widening out this area over here, we now provide room for cars to get around. In addition, so this will eliminate that pinch point and allow better on-site circulation around the dispensers. In addition, with the loading zone over here, we can now actually get delivery trucks in this area. Currently, they park out here. In fact, that is probably the Coke truck that you see on Google Earth that just delivers their product into the store. The large grocery truck just pulls up to the front door. If you could just show, it says figure, I believe, 2, 3, and 4, so we'll just go through them one at a time so that they can see. With these improvements on the site, you can see that this is just a small grocery delivery. A single unit truck can pull into the site, back up, and has all this room, which was the curb line, so they can get in there without causing too much trouble. So this is probably the smallest delivery truck that you would have. If you go to the next figure 3, which is a larger WB tractor trailer truck on this one, you can see they can maneuver around the pumps without having to go onto Torrey Street and back up into the site without driving over parking spaces or anything like that. And lastly is just the disposal truck, which is figure 4, and that just shows driving in straight, dumping, and then being able to back out. So as you'll see with the leasing of this area over here and having this extra room in between the pumps and the parking spaces is just going to provide much more maneuverability on site, better on site circulation, and in addition we get these delivery trucks in a much confined, safer area so that there's less pedestrian and vehicular conflicts with the delivery trucks. Just to point out some things quickly, the store's remaining the same, the pumps remaining the same, so we don't expect any increase in traffic as a result of this. So that's why there were no traffic counts or anything like that done for the project. Thanks.
That concludes our presentation.
Okay, great. Thank you.
All right. Any questions from the board?
Do we have a calculation of the impervious area or the coverage, percentage-wise?
Summary chart.
Yep, that's where I found it. Of course, as soon as you ask a question, you find the answer.
Yeah.
Is there a concern? Or
it was obviously more than half. I just wasn't sure what the result was. And because it is close to the riverfront area, there was a question, Gene, in the DRT notes about what they called rear setback or rear yard. And looking at the proposal, I'd be sort of hard put to identify which property line is the rear yard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we spent a fair amount of time with the building inspector trying to interpret that.
So I looked at the last full site plan review that we did, which was in
2012, I think.
Well, 2012, but before that, with the last major renovations, which was in the 90s, and that had the rear setback as the line, the property line adjacent to the Goddard School. So that's what we would consider the rear, and that's what the building inspector would consider the rear. So in my comments, I had mentioned that, and that we would want an updated site plan to reflect the appropriate rear setback, because what they had shown was that as a side yard setback.
Well, I mean, it was a question, it was a curiosity on my part, because if you look at the Torrey Street lot in isolation, of course, the rear yard setback is the one next to the river.
Mm-hmm. Correct. Yeah.
And I'm not sure when you combine the two lots. Okay. So you basically, the Torrey Street lot goes away, disappears from the... but there was a requirement in the notes about showing that it was a single lot or had been...
I don't know that we've seen the actual deed or anything, but...
The building inspector would require a plan that shows the lots have been combined.
Yeah, but we've had this discussion before where how can we make a decision on a lot we don't believe they control, or we don't know that they control.
Correct.
Well, just to respond, the actual owner of the property is Fairhaven Associates Realty. Mm-hmm. Which is actually an affiliate of Cumberland Farms. As a condition to approval, we'd have to demonstrate ownership and authority to combine the lots, because you're actually, this board isn't undertaking that act this evening, but we certainly could provide whatever is necessary to demonstrate that we have the authority. And what we would be doing is creating an 81X plan instead of an A&R plan that you would typically see, because there aren't any new boundaries being created, so we can put that on record. And that's what we would do. Hopefully that clarifies matters.
Yeah. Okay.
I just recognize that the note of the DRT asking for that evidence.
Yeah.
Are we comfortable handling that as a condition?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm trying to think if we had this issue with
Perfectos and the car dealership the next time.
Yeah.
Right? The whole basis for their making modifications to the site was that they were going to purchase a piece of land, but they hadn't purchased a piece of land yet.
No, that was the issue. They weren't going to purchase the land. The car dealership did not want to actually give up the ownership of that piece of land, but they wanted to use that as part of the buffer, or lease it to them. That was the whole thing. Was that they didn't want to give up that fee ownership.
Okay. So this one is much simpler because they do, I mean, Fairhaven does own the properties. And Fairhaven is basically the captive of Cumberland Farms, so the cooperative.
Well, they don't have to have a relationship with the leasing the property. That doesn't matter. Just somebody has to own that piece of property that has the right to develop on it.
Yeah. And I believe that's the Fairhaven, which is their real estate arm.
Okay, but how do you know that? Where have you seen that?
It was in one of the documents that we were provided with.
Okay.
There's also a letter of authorization within the.
I saw the letter.
Materials that allows.
Yeah, I saw the letter.
Permits and approvals that are required from local boards, local state federal boards. But if there's something that you might need more in excess of what we provided, we can certainly provide that as a condition to approval if the commission so deems that necessary.
I see the letters, I just don't see something that says they own it. And I don't really care, I just know that it was a question that came up in the DRT, so have they been satisfied, has the town been satisfied that they own it? There's something in the JS plan or plot plan, anything?
Well, in the findings, although it probably shouldn't be in the findings section.
Yep.
Under number three, this site plan review and approval is contingent upon evidence that the lots have been combined. It shouldn't really, that should be taken out of the findings and put in as a condition.
Yeah.
Yep.
You with me, Jess?
Yeah.
See that, Jess?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you're going to take three.
Building permit.
Okay. All right. That's fine.
That'll do it.
Although, I guess I would say that I would make it a little bit stronger the way that you have it written here, because this the whole premise of this is that the two lots would be combined. So it's not just a condition prior to the issuance of the building permit. I mean, that can be where it's placed, but the site plan review approval, the entire approval, is contingent upon receipt of that document.
Yes. However, the the owner of the 8 Torrey Street lot could apply for the demo permit independent of the site plan. Because what's being demoed is the property on 8 Torrey Street.
Yeah, but we're not ruling on the demolition. They could
right.
do that tomorrow.
They
could
do that,
ruling
yeah.
on
that.
Conditions for demolition and then conditions for building permit. So this is
right.
just for, yeah, so then that's, if you agree that's an appropriate place to have it.
Yeah. Well, I think that the condition in the building permit is the right place to have the combined lots constraint, because the demo permit all is basically proof of ownership and so forth.
I agree. I'm just I guess I was just saying that the wording of that should be like it's worded in the findings, where the site plan approval is contingent on receipt of that.
Okay.
Instead of, we need it for evidence for compliance with. It's a little bit wishy-washy. It doesn't take the same tone of the importance of that.
Yeah, we have no problem with that.
Do you?
That's
you.
Okay.
It's
I
okay.
Say
semantics.
The site plan review and approval is contingent upon evidence of what being combined. And then just continue with the rest of the statement.
Yes, yeah.
Sorry,
it is
okay.
It's semantics, but I think
sure.
semantics that are important just for the points that Nick brought up
yeah.
earlier.
Do you want me to keep it in the finding as well?
Yeah.
Yeah,
sure.
It can't hurt.
Okay.
Good.
I mean, that is certainly what we found. So.
Yeah.
I think we're good on that point.
Mm-hmm.
I had a question on, I wasn't clear on snow plowing, snow removal. you mind just reviewing how that's gonna work?
This is actually an issue that had come up when we had talked to the Conservation Commission as well. And what happens right now is snow is removed as it falls, basically. There's no space for storage, so whenever it snows, the snow is removed. And that would be the plan moving forward as well.
Okay.
Yeah, we have to work on the language in the decision though, because it doesn't really say that.
And within the site plan, the first note says, snow shall not be stored within sand filter or within any parking spaces, accessways, fire lanes, or riverbank buffer area. All snow from major snow events, 2 inches or more, shall be removed from the property and taken to a designated disposal area. Snow shall be properly disposed of in accordance with applicable federal, state, and or local regulations.
Is that what you want, though?
CF4.0?
You don't want to store anything on the sand area?
No.
Even up to 2 inches? I thought that's the way it was worded earlier in some other stuff, but then the decision said something different. So you're okay with removing it all the time?
Yes.
Okay. Why can't you store it on the sand area? Why can't you store it in the sand area for a small...
It's for preservation of the sand filter. If you're plowing snow into it all the time, it would degrade over time, push things around. Plus you lose your capacity within that sand filter if it's full of snow.
So I'm looking at the memo from the engineering division. It looks like there's one item here that would need to be addressed. I think we can handle it as a condition. I just wanted to make sure that you were aware of that. Under site lighting, first bullet, illumination levels along the southwest property line adjacent to the proposed expanded parking area exceed allowed levels. Appropriate shielding should be provided to reduce illumination levels along the southwesterly property line. Okay. I just scanned this. I don't think there was anything else in there that was of issue, right?
Right.
Okay.
We had conditioned everything else.
That's a really weird light spilling. I'm trying to figure out where it's coming from, because most of the lights over there seem to be the undermounted canopy or overhang lights. I'm not sure why you're getting spillage over there.
Yeah, Paul Wilson, by the way, Cumberland Farms. It just seems to be that's the way that it does trickle out and spread out a little bit. But yeah, we are actually changing out the existing fixtures and swapping them out with LED fixtures. So it's a different type of light right now. They're the drop lens incandescent. Actually, no, they're, I believe, in metal halide. So they have that different glow to them, and they're actually more of a shine light, and LED is more of a wash sort of light, but we can definitely shield it. It is sort of an odd condition because the canopy is so far close up to the property line into the street. We do like to have the whole entire area around the canopy well lit for travel purposes, pedestrian. Again, we can fix it.
I'm gonna stay on lighting. The decision says that proposes two new pole lights on the parking and then one on the western side. But I see four poles, and I think the calculations show four as well.
Where is this? Well, is in the decision?
Yeah, there's three on the new piece, one by the dumpsters, two by the parking, and then there's one at the Salem Street entrance. And the calculation on the luminaire schedule says four as well, but the decision says three.
Can you go back to the
I don't know if my mouse died or
it should work on this too.
Control, Alt, Delete. Really?
Yes.
We do have a couple copies of the photometric plan.
Right.
That was a separate document, right?
So there's the mix-up.
So we've got the two in the parking.
There's two in the parking, one in the dumpsters. One in the dumpsters.
Okay.
Does this one exist?
Which one? Well, no, because I mean, they're proposing four.
One.
So we have one,
Two, three, four.
There's four?
Yeah.
Four total. Parking spaces, one near the dumpster.
Yeah, we are adding four lights. There are two at the new parking area.
Yeah.
Towards the Goddard School.
Okay.
One over the dumpster. That will be pretty much corralled by the dumpster corral, the lighting there. And then there's one at the front of the site closest to Salem Street, to, I would guess, the front of the building. So there are four, total of four.
So we're rephrasing this to Jesse, the plan proposes three new pole lights and then one additional pole light?
Two pole lights near the new parking area, one pole light near the dumpster, and one additional pole light on the western side.
And the thing to remember here is that there's an existing pole out there now that'll be coming down and will be replaced.
Okay, I'll note that as well.
Oh, okay.
It's going to be replaced though in the same location.
Well, more or less, yeah. The existing pole is in the new parking area.
Any other comments or questions from the board?
Yeah, the decision says the dumpster's wrapped in a white vinyl fence, but I think the drawings say it's all stockade fence, right?
Yes.
Wood, it's all wood.
Okay.
New fencing and the dumpster enclosure are all wood.
I see on the detail sheet, on the enclosure isometric, that it's a 6 feet white vinyl fence on the detail sheet. And that the rest.
Yeah, sorry about that inconsistency. This stockade, that we have to change up the specification for that.
Okay.
So
what is
everything
it?
On the site will be stockade.
Stockade.
Correct.
Correct. That's, I would assume that would be a preference.
I think
yeah.
So.
Yeah.
So do we need new anything?
So.
Would we require new plans for that?
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm.
No? Oh, okay.
As a condition, we'd be happy to provide.
Yeah.
Why did we provide?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If there's something else there too, you do.
Sure. Public comment, questions? Anyone from the public have any comments on this project? All right.
Move that the CPDC close the public hearing for the proposed development project at the address.
303 and 303 Salem Street.
303 Salem Street and 8 Torrey Street. Okay. So have we managed, have we captured the updates for the decision?
So for page 3 of 7,
mm-hmm.
after site plan, I will also include a condition for a revised detail sheet, as well as a revised photometric to indicate light is fully contained on the site, where the town engineer had concerns.
Okay.
So we can add those two conditions and everything else will move down.
Okay.
You updated the lighting, number 9, on findings?
Correct.
Okay.
As well as finding 5 to represent stockade fence.
Yep.
Right.
We added a condition there prior to the issuance of the building permit.
That was just to modify condition 3, right?
Condition 3,
yeah, we
finding
3. Finding 3.
Well, we had finding 3, but there's also condition 3, which is the building
updated.
Permit.
Oh, I see, yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Okay.
The as-built plans, those were highlighted for the town engineer, and he is okay with that amount and those two conditions.
Okay.
You guys are okay with that?
Yeah, sure. And as well as the stormwater storage is okay with that as well.
Right.
So I will also update the materials list to include George's memo that did come in this afternoon.
Okay.
All right. John, you good?
Move that the CPDC approve the site plan review decision for the project at 303 Salem Street as amended.
Second.
Those in favor?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Good luck.
Thank you.
So, good. Next up on the agenda, minor site plan review application, 1 General Way for Sola Salon. This is not a public hearing, right?
Correct.
So, okay. Gentlemen here for... Well, hold on, I'm sorry, 1 second. Before you start, let me give staff the opportunity. I just wanted to understand who was here for the project. No problem. Yeah, if you wouldn't mind. Thank you.
That we saw some months back with a revised site plan from 1 General Way. So this is what's before you tonight. Sola Salon is a basically a salon that's got many small stations within it, and so independent stylists are in these multiple small suites. So that's the concept. I think they're 33 suites, 34 suites. And so I can pull up the site plan if that's helpful. So what's before the board tonight is really a minor site plan review that focuses on what this interior build-out is going to do with the site and how it may or may not impact the overall redevelopment plans for the site that was presented some months back.
Great. Want to provide a quick overview of the project?
We're building out a salon. There are 200 solars across the country. This will be the first one in Massachusetts. We have the rights for the whole Middlesex County, and that's always the case. And we plan eventually to end up probably building about 10 of them. But this will be our first one, and we're really feeling very good about your city and looking forward to being a member of your community.
That's great. I'm sorry, your name and...
Larry Oppenheimer, this is my partner, Adam Murray.
Great, thank you.
And we also have a representative, Jamie Shaw, from Danish Realty. They're the owner of the building.
Oh, yeah, that's right, okay.
Yes, we know them well.
And if I could just elaborate on what Larry said there, like Jean said, there's 34 individual suites within the build-out, a total of 37 shares. These are independent stylists, primarily, or other beauty practitioners, and they're basically in business for themselves, and they're, you know, they occupy these suites and do their work independently. They can come and go as they please. So we don't expect, and based on Soul's history and other installations, that there will be, it won't be full at any one time. The estimated peak occupancy is like 75%, which would mean it'd be roughly somewhere between 25 and 28 maximum stylists at any one time.
Normal occupancy is normally about a third.
Okay.
Because people, advantages of owning your own salon is you work the hours you want to work. Some people are morning people, some people want to work in the evening, and some people want to work midday.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Our meeting notice says 37 suites. 34 stylists. Is that?
So it was what?
Is that a typo there?
Yep.
Okay. 34 suites, 37 individual chairs. Three of them are doubles.
Okay. get our arithmetic right. Now, the questions we had the first time this came around was, some of it was the controlled access and hours of operation, question mark? I mean, it's because the interior corridor becomes basically a public space if you've got the individual stylists working discrete hours. So it's individual security on the suites?
Each individual suite is separately keyed. The stylist has entry, and only the stylist, except for management. We'd also make provisions for to enable the fire department or whatnot to have access. The spaces, the exterior of the spaces are going to be automatically locked with electronic keys, and so the stylist will have a fob to enter into the space when the space is not open.
Okay.
How do customers get in?
The space will be open during normal working hours, and the stylist can let the customers in if it's within permissible hours, but outside of the open hours, if that makes sense.
So what I guess. What kind of other management is there on site? What I'm thinking about from a site plan perspective is who controls, who makes sure that they deal with trash appropriately, or parking, you have different parking spaces. I mean, how is that sort of thing controlled? Is there someone on site to help control that? I mean, that's a lot of people, a lot of stylists that might have their own different preferences, ways of doing things.
We've hired a manager who will be the primary, who will manage the site. He'll be the primary contact for the stylists, as well as will oversee the site. But he won't be there all the time. He'll be making periodic visits. And that's pretty typical of the service.
And so there's specific hours that the facility is open, and then that they're expected to work within those hours, or they could decide to open up at at midnight till 2 a.m. And I think there's a, there's some issues there.
It's 9 to 9 in the narrative, I guess.
Right. If somebody wanted to be there at 8:30 in the morning instead of 9, they could buzz the person in and open at 8:30. I think if you give us a limit of when they're not supposed to be there, we will definitely tell them that's not allowed. And we can also probably make the machine not work during those hours. But basically, not many people want their hair cut at 2 in the morning either. Yeah. I mean
you never know.
I didn't mean to offend you, but...
No, I know what you're saying. You said there are lots of people that want to do different things. So.
The typical thing would be early in the morning.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think there's some limits on when business hours, 6 a.m. to,
yeah.
I don't know what the nighttime
midnight.
One is. Midnight. So I think that, right, that would have to be the limitations of...
That's the Town of Reading general bylaws. So.
Right.
I think that's a very big time frame, and they could... I would be surprised if anybody could live with that. They couldn't come.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Dennis is providing the employees, or so-called employee spaces, for the stylists themselves?
We're supplying, excuse me? There's no designated employee parking. They can park wherever they want. We're going to encourage them to park eventually in the back of the building, but until we tear down the back of the building, we're going to encourage them to park along the brook on the outside of the parking lot.
Okay.
Up at the top.
Do you have a time frame as to when that...
The back of the building?
Yeah.
We're in the process of meeting engineers and designing it. We're hoping to get it done by before the fall.
Okay.
Okay.
It'll be late fall before we get a shovel in the ground.
And what's your time frame?
Our time frame is dictated, to be honest, by you guys and the City of Reading, but once we get approval, it will take 3 months to build the place out and have it open.
Okay.
And there's no signage that we're approving as part of this? Oh, because there's a master signage plan?
Right. Dennis has the, or whatever we're calling it, one general way.
So I'm just curious, I think Snap Fitness kind of has something similar, where they don't have anybody necessarily on site at certain hours and people can kind of let themselves in. Have we had any challenges with that or any feedback related to that? I'm just curious.
Yeah, Snap visibility is substantially more than what you
have. That's true, yeah.
Last means of corridors.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
This has the feel of a... To me, this feels like one of those really bad malls in Singapore. usually on the lower levels, and you just got to find your way in and out. There's no visibility from outside. It's a weird space. I don't think I feel safe in there.
It's got 24-hour-a-day cameras, and of the 200...
Okay, so the camera will see somebody getting attacked, but I mean,
The franchise has been in business now for, I think,
10 years.
As of now, and I got a knock on wood like driving a car, there has been no one attacked in the summer.
Okay, let's hope so. But even
I can't guarantee that.
But even the example you gave has much more storefront than this little piece, which is partially my disappointment with Danis. Every time they do something on this property, they have so much potential, and it's always just entrance and 90 feet of solid wall, entrance, 90 feet of solid wall.
Well, we'd love more windows.
So disappointing every time. I think you might have some people movement issues. It's just, it's all enclosed, and you're suggesting that each person is responsible for their individual suite, but that doesn't mean someone's not roaming the corridors. Just from a planning standpoint, it looks not great, but I understand the model.
Kevin, it looks like it's an interesting business model that will likely work fairly well. The advantage of the, one of the few advantages of the One General Way is the very high ceilings. So if you take advantage of that and you can preserve the feeling of openness, you know.
And the, not get into things you probably, guys don't probably care a lot about, but the individual stylists love the concept. I mean, I went all over the country checking with people, and I've got to say, of the 30 or 40 I went to, and I checked with different, there was, the first of all, the average stay in one is like 10 or 15 years, or as long as they've been there, they stay. And the second thing is they decorate these places to look like what they want them to look like. And they make more money, which is never bad. They make more money paying a monthly, a weekly rent than they do paying the average commission rate, which is 60%.
Right.
So with the parking and with them all being, you know, individual business owners, I'm not sure, I can pretty much safely say that there is no incentive for employees or these individual business owners to park away from their storefront, because they, there's no harm to come to their business if they do park in front. Their own individual customer, it's going to be one person, is going to find their spot, no problem. They're going to park in front. So you do, you repeat that, you know, however many people that are there, 20, 25 stylists, 25 customers, and you have everyone parking right in the front. I think there, unless you put some, I don't care. I could care less if you have all, and all your individual stylists could care less. Who's going to care is all the rest of your future tenants that have 50 people, 25 extra cars parked right in front of the storefront. I would personally recommend that you do require as an owner that they have to park, not just recommend, because they're unlike someplace like Market Basket. You maybe Market Basket's not a great, well, yeah, we'll use it. But yeah, Market Basket, you can go into the manager and say, hey, get all your employees to go park out there. And you know what? They'll make sure it happens.
Absolutely.
Right? You don't have the same, you guys don't even have the same control over that. They're just going to say, yeah, right, right.
So, but the entrance is such that I owned a chain of toy stores in Minnesota. If I could have, and I did park him back behind my store, if I could have parked where Danis is talking about building the parking, unless that thing is chucked forward, you have to go to the far end, your likelihood is you can get in that back door a lot closer than you could park anywhere in the parking lot. So yeah. I would park in the back, get in the door, and then walk down the warm, heated aisleway to our space. So in that way, you know, I mean, if you want to park right in front of the space, that would be true. There are a few parking spaces right in front of our space that maybe somebody will take. But the majority of people probably find it easier to park in the back, go down that little hallway, and go to the thing. And Market Basket, the other day, I asked him, because when I went into my space, I saw a whole lot of people from Market Basket parking right in front of my store. And I asked the manager when I went in, and he said, they're not supposed to do that. So yes, I wouldn't have bought, we weren't open yet, but if I was the clothing store that was like next to us, it would have driven me nuts. And it would drive me nuts if I was doing it now. It's very hard to keep employees parking where they should unless you do something like put a sticker on the car. And even then, I would think that you'd want them to park there during busy times. But in the evening, when safety becomes an issue, then I would say to a 40-year-old, to anybody, but I would say to anybody parking as a stylist, if she's there in the evening and the parking lot's not full, I would want her to park right in front of the store. I mean, if there's empty spaces and it's safer, that to me is the number one priority, rather than if it's Saturday and the place is jammed, it's the middle of the day, you don't have a security issue. But I don't want to, I ran as many as 8 toy stores. I never had a person attacked, but I also never want to have a person attacked.
It's a different model right. Where you just don't have as much control, and in your particular condition here where the entrance is sort of tucked into the corner, there really aren't a lot of spaces in the front. It'll only take a couple of stylists
well,
to suddenly fill up. Feel
the,
like it's all full up.
The so. One thing that we should do, and you made a really good point, is as when they come to sign the lease, say to them just what you just said. It may not seem like a big deal to you if you park in front during busy times, but all that has to happen is 4 or 5 of you do it, and then the spaces are gone. And in that way, they hopefully will realize, but you know, there are no guarantees that they'll be smart enough to do that.
One of our jobs in running this space is to manage the stylists themselves. They're independent
right.
contractors, obviously, but they're still leasing from us. They'll have interaction issues. They'll have issues with us. And that's one of our jobs, is to be dealing with them on an ongoing basis. And that certainly would be one of the issues that we'll be talking to them about.
And if one stylist sees another stylist parking there, I almost guarantee you she will be calling our manager saying, you know, I want customers to park there. What's this woman doing there?
Or man, for that.
Oh, man. I mean, whereas in Market Basket, if you're Jimmy and Meats and you see George and Derry parking there, you don't care. But in this case, it's taking away from your customer's space and you make your money.
Yeah, certain aspect of self-policing, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Any other comments or questions?
No, I'm fascinated by it.
Where's the library going in relation to this? Right next door?
Yeah, the library's over here. They're here. The library's over here.
All right.
This site plan is the best. We've asked for an updated site plan.
Yeah. Just thinking, I mean, if there's two big projects going on at the same time, just be aware of setting up a temporary library right next door to you. I saw September in the newspaper. Right?
Yeah, it was in the newspaper last week.
That's fast.
I think the month of September, so it could fall squarely in line with your timeline as well. So just be aware of that.
Better that the construction should be going on concurrently than.
Yeah.
I think it will be great for the shopping mall to have a library there temporarily. It brings traffic.
Yeah. Sure.
Can I ask a question? Do you, and I'm new to Massachusetts in general, do you allow, in Minnesota, they always allowed you a temporary sign banner when you opened. Is that not permitted at all in Reading, or can you do it for a month, or what is the rules?
That's regulated by the building inspector. Requires filing for a building permit for a temporary banner.
Okay.
So as long as you do that, you get your permit, square it all with the building inspector, you're allowed a grand opening banner
okay,
or whatever.
Sure. And he's in charge of it, or there's only one person?
Correct.
That's great. You're going to have to go to another committee and everything.
Oh, yeah.
Nope.
No, you're good.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Yeah, we fixed that some time ago.
Yeah.
Are we ready for the?
Yeah, do we want to take a look at this?
Well, of course.
Is that what you were suggesting?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I would just add at the findings at the bottom of number one, where it says total of 37 studios with, I would add with 37 chairs.
34 studios, yeah.
34 studios with 37 chairs, because that really tells you how many people are there.
Gene and Jesse, were you comfortable, satisfied with their response regarding parking? Or not parking,
trash collection?
Are we in a trash?
Yeah, trash collection.
Yeah, we got a plan.
So you indicate that the stylists will be disposing of the trash in their own studios, which will then be collected at a central trash can in the space itself, which will then be removed off-site.
And daily will be brought to the dumpster. Same way that Adam does it for the state of New Hampshire.
Where's the dumpster?
The rear of the building where the yellow highlighted square is.
So that actually might be incentive to park in back, because you take the trash with you as you leave.
Yep.
Dump it and take off.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So some of them might do that.
So I'll just update the finding to reflect how this will happen based on their response.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, finding number 4.
Are we changing number 5, the hours of operation, or are we going to keep it?
Well, the Town of Reading bylaws is, what, 6 a.m. to 12 p.m.?
I would just say hours of operation shall comply with the Town of Reading bylaws.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And they can work within those hours.
Engineer?
Yes.
Okay, so you're aware that he wants an updated site plan to reflect the current parking?
Yes, we're working on it.
Okay.
Everybody all right? Any other?
Johnny? Any other concerns?
Still reading?
That the CPDC approve the minor site plan review decision for the project at One General Way, Sola Salon, as amended.
Second.
All those in favor?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Good luck.
We good? Break or keep moving?
No.
5 minutes.
Yeah.
You can take that.
Sure.
Yeah.
5 minutes.
We'll be in touch.
Okay, great. Thanks.
So this project should help us supersede Stoneham as the town with the most per capita salons, right?
No other way to state or the country.
We do it by chairs.
By chairs.
We're
no way to do
what?
That.
We're taking a break.
Yeah, we'll take a 5 minute break. We'll come back at 8:45. I've got 8:39.
Jesse, do you want to go, or you want me to provide it?
I can start.
Yeah, sure.
So we have had something in the order of 30-odd public meetings of the Zoning Advisory Committee. Of those, about four of them were designed as public forums, and we used the Turning Point technology to get input from the audience, which was pretty interesting, because you see it instantaneously on the PowerPoint, what the responses tally up to. So we got a lot of good feedback. We also did a lot of outreach into the community. So rather than just have a public meeting and hope people come, we actually went to some of the groups in town that we thought might be of interest, like the Chamber. Reading Cooperative Bank had an after-hours meeting, and we got a lot of business people. We went to the Lions group, we went to the Rotary. So we really tried to do that with as many groups as we could find that would be of interest in the topic. We also have, obviously, the website, which has got a lot of information on there. We have the sections that are completed and ready for public view are already posted on the website, and many more of the sections that are in draft form, the committee's working on finalizing and getting closer to a final product. So I think tomorrow night is the sort of the presentation to the Board of Selectmen that we had always said July 15th we would present the draft. And essentially, the things that we are recommending, besides what's kind of been a little bit of the hang-ups on non-conforming uses, lots, and structures, mostly all those non-conforming lots that we thought we had structured this so that people putting decks on in a downtown, you know, Green Street house wouldn't be bothered with a special permit. So I think that got fixed in this new version. But other things that we needed to do, like I think we had maybe 60 definitions in the current zoning bylaw, and the new draft has over 300. So a lot of definitions, many of which this board had a big role in putting together, at least putting out there, we need a definition for. So by virtue of having all those additional definitions, we now have the building blocks for guiding people in zoning with the definitions. That was, we spent a huge amount of time on that, and it was, I think, time well spent, both by CPDC and the Zoning Advisory Committee. The other sections, obviously, Section 4 is like 100 pages. So with the consultant's help, we delved into accessory apartments, site plan review, aquifer protection district. Section 4 was a bear, but we're pretty well through it. There's a few little more tweaks we're working on. And then the other big section, obviously, is Section 6, which is parking, signs, and the non-conforming. Non-conforming being the real big one, because the Zoning Board of Appeals gets applicants that come to them for routine things that, I think we've talked about it here, that really isn't why we want people to go to the special, to a special permit for something that can otherwise be helped routinely by staff. So medical marijuana is a big thing. I think we're calling that Section 4, but we have that pretty well drafted. You might recall that we will, the temporary moratorium expires in November, so definitely medical marijuana will go. And there's some discussion about having a meeting in September with the town meeting members, and it may even be a special town meeting. So there'll be more to follow on that. There are a couple other things that the town needs to do in September. So if we can get a special town meeting in September, then we can put medical marijuana, hopefully, on that town meeting and be done with it. And then the full zoning bylaw in November.
It will be formatted to fit into the new code?
Well, there's the little bit of clerical magic that we're probably going to have to do. And we've talked about the concept rather than the details of it. But the medical marijuana regulation, we want to make absolutely sure that it's handled as a separate article. And the we can do it either of two ways. We can either have an article that follows the zoning article, the comprehensive update, and the comprehensive update would include the provisions that we've talked about on the medical marijuana along with all the other changes. If that passes, then you could abandon the subsequent motion, which would be written against the existing bylaw. Or you could invert the process so that you can have a medical marijuana article written against the existing bylaw and do that first, and then ensure that in the comprehensive update we include basically the same provisions. But it's one or the other. It's going to be a topic of discussion, obviously, at town meeting, no matter which way we do it.
The September town meeting, we have a tentative date for it. I think it's September 29th. So what that's going to allow us to do is two things. Put medical marijuana on there as a standalone, and then we'll have town meeting there, and we can present the lion's share of what we've done just as an informational update to town meeting. They wouldn't be voting on the rest of the zoning bylaw until November. Hmm. But they're all going to be there. So if we need to have discussion about, you know, some of the trickier things of like aquifer protection district and accessory apartments, some of the things that we're talking about are, you know, things that town meeting is going to have to agree to, and they may not be ready for that. Like, for example, with accessory apartments, the draft currently says that if you put one in your primary structure, you don't have to go for a special permit. If it's in an addition or in some other accessory structure, then you do. And I'm not sure where town meeting will be on that. I know there's been, at Zoning Board of Appeals last Thursday, there was a fair amount of discussion and debate and concern about Mr. Wise, who was here with the tree and the, and that was ultimately withdrawn last Thursday.
Hmm.
So,
really?
He withdrew his proposal because there was a lot of concern about what he was trying to do with the accessory apartment and taking down the tree and adding the driveway. So,
that wasn't the pure. That was a very confusing proposal by him, I think.
Yeah.
Well, it
just
was
an accessory apartment.
Yeah.
I think it would have had more success. Just
yeah.
That scenic road thing didn't help either.
No, I really think that what was going on with the house went well beyond what an accessory apartment was.
Right.
Yeah.
They caught that.
Yeah, I mean, he was, unfortunately, it's a prominent location.
Yeah.
On, you know, basically two scenic ways.
Two scenic ways, yeah.
Yeah.
But anyway, I think the September date will be an opportunity to accomplish two things. One, get feedback and provide a forum for town meeting members to understand what's going on broadly, but then specifically for medical marijuana.
Well, given that this is the middle of July, is there a statutory time frame?
Yeah, we're
risk
with
the, if it were a special town meeting?
No, we've got that under control. So I think it'll probably be announced tomorrow night at the Board of Selectmen meeting, for sure, one way or the other.
And would that be the only warrant? Medical marijuana, or would it have?
Oh, no, there's going to be multiple things on there.
Oh, all right.
From some of the other parts of town that need the town meeting in September.
Okay.
So it'll be called as a special, which would be a nice opportunity, because we kept wringing our hands saying, how are we going to get all the town meeting members to come? You know, we've had about, you know, 25-30% participation town meeting members. But what about the other 70%? And
how do we engage them in this topic? It's kind of dry. So now we have a captive audience in September, which is good.
Yep.
Nick and John, are you aware of where we landed with medical marijuana?
No. I've been meaning to come to some of these meetings, and it just doesn't fall on the right day.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where we've ended up is, to a certain extent, a minimalist approach, because the state regulations are fairly extensive. And we have now, the state has issued the second round of detail. And it appears to be enough to just go ahead and use, because we don't have to add a lot of our own constraint or regulations or whatever. We basically say, you know, as according to the state laws, and aim for, what would we say, the industrial district?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Built into the state law is the 500-foot buffer from areas of young people may congregate, kind of thing, like the entertainment venues or churches or schools or whatever.
How does that work if the medical marijuana place goes in first and then somebody wants to put in a,
that question was asked,
right?
A deli or,
I think,
or
the
something
town would
well, the
probably a question not for now, but
yeah.
But I thought
what
of
does that mean? Does that mean
answer
that the American marijuana place has to move, or that person can't put their yogurt place in or something?
I thought it was the latter.
Mm.
Yeah, it's, you know, the
well, that's weird, because I'd rather have, you know, you're saying that potentially some thriving business enterprise can't go into an open spot because this other facility is there.
I don't.
That's really weird.
Yeah, I think they would be allowed. I think you're saying like a daycare go in after a medical marijuana treatment facility was located
sure.
somewhere.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think the discussion was that they would be allowed to, whether or not they would want to.
Well, what's the concern then? You know, it's just a stupid rule, because if they're concerned that the one facility impacts the other negatively, and they don't want it near it, but then you're allowing the second one to come in.
By choice.
A choice.
Yeah.
It's a stupid rule.
Right.
My biggest concern with it is what's happening with Washington State and Colorado, where they have the recreational use, but they're still sort of up against the federal laws that don't allow them to use banks and
yep.
financial institutions
mm-hmm.
as a cash business, and that just creates other problems. So
well,
I'm not sure if that is that
state,
not an issue here?
Well, the state has recognized that and is working on ways around that. I don't know the details, but I've noticed the it come up in the news, basically.
But it's not resolved yet.
Is that a map of the?
No, but it's unlikely. I mean, there's nothing that we can necessarily do about it ourselves. I mean, we had the meeting, the joint meeting with the Arcasa folk and the police chief and so forth, and everybody is well aware of the circumstances. Or, you know, the
whole town forest should be circled.
Hmm?
The whole town, everything that's wooded that you can ride a bike through should be
circled.
John's bike path should be completely out.
So is that a map of the buffers around the where it can't be?
Yes. These are the 500 feet per the state regs. Of anything, they call it where children congregate.
And mm-hmm. is there a definition for that?
There is.
Yeah.
That means school.
Schools, daycare. We included Matera Cabin.
Like dance schools.
Dance
karate.
Schools.
Churches that have daycares, not just churches, but those.
And they even included the trapeze school.
Trapeze school, which.
I think we're gonna. I would say we should just remove it, because that could bog us down.
I think they're closed.
Well,
yeah,
we
heard that they might not be around a whole lot longer anyway.
Are we talking about the thing at Jordan's?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, but that whole front end is set up exactly for children, for people to bring their children to.
Yeah.
Ice cream.
Yeah. Well, that's, I mean,
I don't think you can do ice cream.
Well, but
movie
the thing is, if you exclude it, you lose nothing because it's surrounded by a parking lot and Home Depot.
Right.
So, I mean, it's.
Yeah, we said the industrial zone.
So the point, I guess, the to cut to the chase here, though, is all the non. Where are there non residential locations that aren't within that, those buffers? Very little.
Well,
I'm seeing
the
A
few little slivers there.
So if you're going to count the trapeze school, it's this and the industrial.
But almost nothing in business B, that little area where the church is on Chute Street.
Mm-hmm. Right here, the green.
Well, the combination of the buffer zones and the industrial, I mean, is puts it, you know, around the railroad tracks.
So we don't want business A? We don't think business A is an appropriate location?
Well, I suggested that and was, it did not strike a chord with anybody.
It's just more visible than a lot of the industrial, which has all those little inroads.
Yeah, the police chief was at the meeting and he said he did not feel that this was tucking it into a hidden corner if it went to industrial, because people were concerned about that too.
Yeah.
And he was absolutely clear that there's no hidden corners in this industrial district.
You know, if it's next to the wine bunker or the Sola Salon, I mean, that's no big deal as far as I'm
concerned. Baby warehouse?
Well,
babies,
they don't congregate.
They don't have a bunch of babies hanging out.
There's a daycare center in the gym.
That doesn't count. It's actually not considered a daycare center. It's like babysitting.
Okay. I just think it's a weird rule. I understand schools, you know, like definitive things like that, but the other ones I think are gonna get weird.
Yes.
Is it?
Coming to Resident 130 John Street, there's also going to be a library in that area.
Yes.
Yep.
That's got to count.
In here.
That would count.
So those buffers, okay, so we're going to stay in the industrial zone, I guess that's the way it's written right now. But if it were allowed elsewhere, those buffers would be constantly moving as the little ballet schools go out of business or change locations, that potentially that outline changes.
Mm-hmm.
And
this is just a snapshot.
Site opens up, yeah.
Is it
a strange rule?
It's a very strange provision.
Is it the building or is it the site?
It depends.
Of course.
This map is based on the parcel.
This map is based on the partial, but we don't know about the.
It could be the site. Like if it was a park, obviously.
Like the entire school.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I'm just thinking, like the trapeze school is a use within a building.
Mm-hmm.
Is it just the building?
In that case, the
and
building.
Because that's very different than the buffer around the building is significantly different than the buffer around the site.
Yep.
Buffer around the site encapsulates half of red.
I know. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So we're just going to adopt whatever the state regs are. Do we have the right to modify those at all?
Yep.
Yes.
And enhance them, right?
Enhance.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Lexington did 1,000 feet.
Yeah, some of them you can, like the 500-foot buffer is a default, you know, if you don't override it. But obviously the qualification for the applicants and the registration and so on and so forth,
We don't want that.
Yeah, we can't override that stuff.
No, I'm just thinking about John's Point, the trapeze school, for example. It's on, you know, it's on the north side, I guess, of that building on a different level, and it really is just access from the one point. Doing an outline around the entire building takes away, you know, everything on the Home Depot side. If that storefront were to become available, that's not necessarily an inappropriate place for it. It's
right.
Sheltered, so that's why I'm wondering whether we have the ability to say, well, it's whether we have the ability to develop the outline, make it more reasonable if we think it's unreasonable. Yeah. I just like having more control locally, that's all.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's necessarily going to come up for site plan review, so.
I'm going to be gone in 5 or 10 years when it's when it goes Colorado's way.
Yeah,
you're right.
But just so you're aware, there was a meeting with CASA and Chief Police, and everybody at the end felt comfortable with where we landed. Industrial adopts the, or just adhere to the bylaws of the state, keep it simple as far as we're going to put in our bylaw. And I think our CASA is eventually going to endorse it.
Yes.
Is that the right word?
Yep.
So.
So it's really as simple as, or I think what I hear you saying is modifying the table of uses, defining what it is, which we have already done one.
Yep.
And modifying the table of uses to allow that in the industrial district, and then some clauses in there about that it has to pertain to the state.
Right.
The state requirements.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, it's basically it's almost a one pager. Which is exactly what we want.
Yes.
Okay. Do we want to talk about non-conforming? I guess my first question is, has anyone had an opportunity to review it beforehand?
Well, yes, I did.
I know you have.
Yeah, I had some questions, some edits. I don't know. I think some edits, maybe.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, with the tracked changes version is sort of hard to interpret.
No, it's pretty clear. I mean, the new stuff is underlined and the strike through text is deleted.
So Gene has
the clean
version
that's easier.
Okay, let's see.
Does this include Dave's language? Okay, good.
I have a printed version of it if it's easier for you, Nick.
I'm having trouble with that first 631, the first sentence, last three or four words, but where it says except for, it doesn't seem to make sense. This bylaw shall apply to uses or structures lawfully in existence or lawfully begun, except for a building or special permit issued before the first publication of notice of the public hearing required by law or any relevant portion.
This is the portion that we were supposed to get rid of. We're supposed to move that.
I guess I'm...
That's the grandfather provision that doesn't belong to
I would ask why you even have this, because the entire zoning bylaw pertains only to uses and structures that were lawfully in existence or anyone. I mean, that. Well, this clause is for anything that comes in the town of Reading, right?
Yeah.
So
that's why
I think it probably made sense when this was a little bit separate and it was just being approved by town meeting by itself. But I think as part of a whole rewrite, I'm not sure why we need to have that section in there.
Well, I was surprised to discover that it was still there because meeting last week we got rid of it.
I don't think we got.
No. We moved it to like section 1.10 or something of the zoning bylaw.
So would only
we questioned it whether or not we were just going to get rid of it or just make sure that Ralph blessed it before we got rid of it. I think that's why
we're
it's
waiting
still
for
there.
Him to bless it.
Yeah.
Is that what you're
okay. Yeah, before we start pulling things out, we just want to make sure.
Fair. Yeah. Well, that's good though that we're thinking along the same lines here.
Good.
Yeah, well, okay.
Under 6331, 6331, right, so that's the first paragraph under non-conforming structures. The second sentence says, non-conforming structure that does or will not extend. I really think that should say does not or will not, right? Is that what we're trying to say? Because otherwise it says that it does extend or will not extend, sort of.
Okay.
That does not or will not? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I really think it needs to say does not or will not. Because otherwise you're saying that it does extend. So 6331.
Yep.
End of that sentence. Does. Second sentence. No, up a little. All the way to the end. Right there.
Does
not. Four, it looks like you're asking for a input on the title where it says variance required. I'm just wondering why I can't just say variance or variances. Unless you can think of something else. So now on the next page, it's 635, and 635 has through E.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The last E should be lowercase, but I'm wondering if the end of D, right before E, whether that and should be an or, because the lead paragraph says, let's see.
Any of the
following, right, as opposed to all, which I think the and implies.
So frontage or width requirements?
No, it says lot coverage and building height requirements.
Okay, so that should be or.
Colon, and then the and at the end of that, right there. That and should be or.
Or just building height.
Correct. But either way, I think the or makes it clear that the and can't be there. Six, three, seven, single lot exemption. The paragraph starts, any increase in area, and I'm just wondering if that should say any future increase or if anybody has an opinion on that.
Any increase in area, frontage, width, yard, or depth required for loan shall not apply to the
or does that even mean anything? Does that really mean anything? Any increase in area. Yeah, because what it's trying to say is that if we, it's not saying that the applicant is going to come in and increase lot area or frontage, right? We're saying the bylaw would change to increase the requirement.
Which means that we should reword it to say any future zoning bylaw change.
There you go.
Why would we be including in the bylaw something about a future bylaw change?
Well, I think they're trying to protect a piece of property here, right? The way it's written right now, it almost reads as though the applicant would come in and propose an increase in area, frontage, or yard, or depth requirements. But it's really about future changes to the bylaw not impacting these lots. Right, this has got to be the Green Street stuff or whatever we're talking about. The downtown, the little lots in the downtown, right? Mm-hmm. So however we word this, it has to be about any future changes to the zoning bylaw don't impact these lots.
Are you saying like when S went from S10 to S15?
Right.
So
right.
When it went from S10 to S15, was 10,000 was the minimum lot size, and it's 15,000.
Right. So we create a non-conformance, and then those people are subject to all of the special permits or variances. And we're trying to eliminate that review from ZBA.
I get it, but you're putting in a code wording to protect against future wording in the code that doesn't yet exist. I understand the forward-looking thought of it, but I'm not sure that's quite appropriate to do in zoning code. Because right now, it's in here and it means absolutely nothing to anyone.
Yeah, you're right. It needs to be set up almost like a special district. Like the A district is not subject to future changes somehow. I don't know what the proper way to do that, but the way I read it, it's not doing what it's supposed to do the way it's written. And you're saying it shouldn't be in there anyways. How do we protect
Correct.
Those lots? Or how do we get those lots out of having to go for a special permit when they want to add a deck?
Well we did that already.
That's
we did
here.
That with the first sentence of 632. Which is new. We said if it's basically a single or two family house, you know, pre-existing thing, then it's, you know, alteration is some things by right and other things by special permit.
Okay, so then what's this section doing?
Nothing. We should probably get rid of it.
All right, we'll have Ralph look at it, I guess, right?
Yeah, I
maybe there's an explanation that we're just not seeing right this second, but
what was that?
Maybe there's an explanation that we're not seeing.
So can we go back to 632 for a second?
Sure.
Since we brought it up. So we're talking about non-conforming uses in here, not non-conforming structures.
Right.
Okay.
This is specifically if the non-conforming use is single family or two family residential.
No, just in general. No, I agree with that. That's what
okay.
that sentence says, yeah. So. But it says here, the following types of changes to non-conforming uses may be considered by the Board of Appeals. Modification of the use or extension of the existing non-conforming use. Now, getting on my soapbox, I know that extension of the use has been, is confusing. Because it's not extension of the structure. If you have a non-conforming use, it's a multifamily dwelling, and you want to add on to that multifamily dwelling, and that addition is compliant with everything, you're not extending the use because you're extending the structure. It's two different things, and it's been interpreted here that extending the structure of a non-conforming use it is the same as extending the non-conforming use, and those are two different things.
Well,
I think there's something else in there for the use.
The issue is in that particular one is that you're increasing the intensity of the use.
You know,
if you're increasing the number of units, you're increasing
I didn't
the
say
intensity.
That. I didn't say that. I would agree. Yes. If you're increasing the number of units, you are increasing the intensity of the use and extending the use. But if you're putting on a mudroom, you're not adding to the number of if you're putting a deck onto a non-existing a non-conforming multifamily unit. You know, it's a non-conforming use. You're putting on a deck. You're not extending the use. You're not increasing
which
the intensity.
Which is why the multifamily.
Yeah.
You have to go to a much harsher example, though. You have to say that there's an auto garage in a residential neighborhood that's been there forever, right?
Yeah.
It's a non-conforming use. He wants to add a bay.
That
so now he starts pushing that use further into the residential or closer to his neighbors. That's
if he wants to that by adding a bay he might be extending that use,
right?
but if, because that's increasing his or her ability to increase the intensity of the business, right?
Right.
But if that person is adding on an addition to put on a bathroom, an employee bathroom out by the garage.
Why would we want to disallow it?
Didn't we do that in 6.3.5E? Doesn't that the provisions of this section shall apply regardless of whether the lot complies with current area, frontage, and width requirements?
No, but 6.3.5 is residential only.
And that's a structure.
Regardless of whether the lot complies with current area, frontage, and width requirements. I thought that was how we...
Yeah, but that's for residential.
Right.
He's not talking about residential. He's talking about non-conforming use.
Versus a non-conforming structure.
Okay.
Like P&S.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Tony, did you have a...
Yeah, that's a perfect example.
Yeah,
P&S. If P&S wanted to add on... their building,
yeah,
right. That's if they're not adding square footage of the retail use, but they're just adding on to the building. That's not he's
increasing the nonconformity.
He's not increasing the nonconformity. It's a use.
No, I know, but he wouldn't be allowed to do that. Is what you're saying?
No. If he comes in and doubles the square footage of his retail part,
right.
Yes, that falls under there. It's increasing his non-conforming use. If he comes in and adds an addition on the residential portion of his property,
okay.
Everything else fits within, he doesn't have to come in here and because he's got a non-conforming use on that and go through this process. Although that's the way it's been interpreted.
Well, yeah, and we're hoping to encourage a different interpretation.
And all I'm getting at is the term extension, modification or extension to the nonconforming use is such a sort of a wishy-washy word.
Well, did we define non-conforming use and structure in the new definition so we do a better job of defining them?
Yeah.
Maybe that helps.
Does it fix it if we change the word extension to expansion?
Intensity?
Yeah, something like that, yeah. Probably either of those. Increased intensity or... even expansion.
Does not expand or increase
yes,
the intensity.
Yeah.
Let's give Tony a turn.
No, I was referring back to section 6.3, I forget what it was, the 5,000 square foot lot that applies to vacant lots, and I believe it's also coded in the state bylaws. Where if you had a pre-existing minimum 5,000 square foot lot before the zoning change, so long as it was not joined in compatible with another existing lot, so the same person couldn't own two lots side by side, you by right could build on that lot.
You are right.
So we fix that, but just by adding the according to state
I had it
law, blah, blah, blah.
And I do remember looking that up.
So we have to reference the state. This reference the state statute to clarify that.
That's talking about a new lot, though, right? Single
no,
lot.
Existing lot. But there can be no structures on it. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
So back to 632. Shall we say, okay, remembering that this is things that the Board of Appeals may consider. It would be modification, expansion, or increase in intensity. Increased intensity.
Well, it uses the word extend three times in here. Right. The whole purpose here is the board may grant a special permit to change or extend a non-conforming use, only if it determines. So my only point here is that word extend has been misinterpreted.
So change or increase? What?
Yeah.
Didn't we use the term alteration when we did this? Where alteration could be, it could be an extension, modification. I thought the word alteration was something that when we updated it last time, Alan had suggested that would kind of cover everything.
Well, I mean, 6332, we say, you know, reconstruction, extension, alteration, or change, which sort of covers everything.
Everything.
But
yeah, I think in this section, though, the concern really is the expansion.
Expansion.
Not the alteration.
Yeah.
Somebody
yeah.
could come in and have a small business that they redo the look of,
yeah.
and that's not a bad thing.
It's
they're not changing anything about how they run their business. They're just making it look better. That's the alteration part.
And maybe that's it, is expansion.
Yeah.
Change or expansion of non-conforming use.
Special permit for change. Let's say for change or expansion. Of a non-conforming use. Reads okay.
Is that what you're proposing, the language?
Yeah.
Did you get that, Jan?
Yep.
Did the ZBA review it on Thursday?
No, they didn't. We're going to try and get comments from them electronically.
Okay.
We hadn't forwarded it along because we weren't really sure it was ready to be presented to them.
Okay. Any other comments on non-conforming?
Had one question, I guess, on 639. Looks like 639, reconstruction after catastrophe. And it says that it can be rebuilt within 2 years of the occurrence. And I'm just wondering what happens if there's some sort of extended litigation. You know, insurance companies and lawyers have a way of doing things like that to people. And they may win the case and get their money to build, and then it's beyond 2 years, what happens?
Apply for the building permit first.
For what? What kind of building permit? You have to get plans together? And
this came up recently.
We don't have to solve it now, but it's just it's
no,
something that's
No, this did
important.
Come up recently, and I'm trying to remember. remember what the solution was. Something about, as long as they applied for the demo permit, they had applied for the demo permit, which really isn't much of anything. There's no plans, there's no... And that was a placeholder for them. We asked town council.
So you apply for the demo permit?
Yep.
Within 2 years?
Yep.
And then it's any amount of time after that?
And you're in, basically.
Okay.
Well, unless you subsequently fall into the 6311 abandonment or non-use, but that would be...
I think that's, when I've talked to Ellen about this before, she said it's a very hard test to meet.
Mm-hmm.
Because even with Perfecto, with the tuck shop, there was some discussion, I think it was at the ZBA, well, has this been abandoned? And because they've been doing some amount of work, as minimal as it was, the lawyers decided, oh no, this isn't abandoned. That's a very high watermark for meeting that criteria. So if you do anything, you don't fall into this.
It's too bad.
I don't know if that's the intent or.
Okay.
638, change, extension, alteration of pre-existing non-conforming lot. These are all as a matter of right. I'm not sure that's the right terminology to use, but what happens if someone wants to change, extend, or alter it in some other way?
What do you mean? This, then they get a special permit as in 636.
But we don't say that, right?
Okay, well, this is applicable to this is like the A&R for a non-conforming lot. As you can make it bigger, you can't make it smaller. It is, I think, the way it works. What it's meant to net out to. But it's changing to the lot rather than the structure. It says that you can do it by right if the result is conformant. Or if all you did is make it bigger without reducing area frontage, width, or depth.
I guess if there are two non-conforming lots next to each other,
mm-hmm.
and they are, I'm just playing devil's advocate here for a minute, and their lot line does this, right, between the two, it's something crooked,
right,
and they don't want it like that, they want it instead, the neighbors, they want it to look like that, that instead. Right, they want the jog here. They're not changing, they're not adding, subtracting, they're modifying. I'm not sure they can do something like that under here because they're not necessarily by right. They're not bringing it into total conformance. In one case, they may be
doing one thing but on one lot, but one non-conformance is being replaced by another non-conformance on the other lot. They're both non-conforming. No harm, no foul, really, but because they can't do it by right, there's not a process to do that.
But item C allows precisely that, I believe.
Oh, that's my place. But if they're two,
then you'd be adding land to the other non-conforming.
Right, because they're two adjacent non-conforming in somewhat, some very slight little way. It's you're never going to get it exactly even. So, what I'm getting at is, because there's no other, we don't have another remedy in here for a special permit. Even those, if it's a change by a half a square foot, no big deal. It, you know, because you can't make the lines line up exactly right. It's not going to really impact anyone. There's no remedy for it. We don't have a remedy baked into here. Because you can either do it by right or you can't do it.
Mm-hmm.
I think this covers 98% of the things that would be done, but those 2%.
You want something like any alteration of the lot beyond this would have to go by special permit.
Yes, something.
Or something.
Yes. Yeah.
Or variance or.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Is that language we can?
Yeah, well, that's
Ralph. Yeah.
Well, that's basically the. Another iteration on 636. It says, if the above doesn't apply, then the ZBA may grant a special permit.
Yeah.
So you basically you iterate 636 for the lot as opposed to the structure.
So basically saying for anything else, 636 is going to apply, even under lots.
Well, basically, I mean, repeat.
Repeat that
repeats
language.
It, yeah.
Repeat
yeah.
says, you know, if the.
Right below it, insert the same language.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a good.
If the ZBA determines that that section doesn't apply, the ZBA may allow it by special permit.
Yeah.
George? Hello.
So the overriding criterion here is substantially detrimental to neighbors. That's what we're looking at. In my letter to Zach, I asked for consideration of other criteria that might be perhaps not equally important to the neighbors, but to the adjacent neighbors, but to the neighborhood. For example, sometimes the state character or the neighborhood character is such that some properties are really exemptions where they don't follow the norm. So if you isolate them and you look at their adjacent properties and the impacts in a micro scale, you may rule one way. But if you look at two or three blocks, the neighborhood as a whole, there may be a reason to rule the other way. And one good example is West Street, or Summer Street for that matter, where the neighborhood character of those two streets has special, there are some special locations which are different than what we consider, you know, historic district or historic street, if you want to talk about Summer Street. So the question is, why have only one criterion? Since we want ZBA to be ruling with an eye on the ground and considering all the parameters, why have one criterion and basically tie their hands?
Well, right, it says it's to the neighborhood, more detrimental to the neighborhood. I can argue, I think I could argue, I could argue for the same house that the neighborhood is three different areas, depending on the context, you know? And so I think that does, the neighborhood, it doesn't say block, it doesn't say adjacent properties. It's a neighborhood is a pretty amorphous area.
Basically the vicinity.
And so I think that does provide, I would argue to you that does provide flexibility enough that if there is evidence, someone wants to bring evidence that says, yeah, you're looking at this a little too narrow, look at the totality of this area, this entire neighborhood here that stretches from, you know, from this place to this place, then I think it gives enough flexibility that if the ZBA wants to do that, they could hear that. That's what I would argue. Yeah.
one other parameter that I thought might be important is sustainable or green design. Some people may try to do the right thing with low impact developments, low impact techniques. They may have existing trees they don't want to cut or fences. Why wouldn't they be allowed to use green practices as another reason to balance impacts on neighbors? You know, within reason, obviously, and leave it to ZBA, but wouldn't that be a stated reason in our bylaw? And again, it's about 636, not, I don't know about 637, we're looking at 636, where a non-conforming structure will maybe altered or in some doesn't change and remain non-conforming. But before and after, it's still a non-conforming structure. So, these were the only two criteria I could think. Mm-hmm. You know, the macro scale of the neighborhood, and I get what you're saying, and the perhaps green practices, I don't want to call them sustainable, I'll say green practices or perhaps preservation practices.
Yeah.
Any other comments on non-conforming? Tony?
Tony Durazzo, 130 John Street. Mr. Chairman, section 6.3.10. I'm not certain, but the way that's worded to me, it sounds very overwhelming in that it states that the bylaw shall be in conformance with this zoning bylaw except in the following circumstances. Basically, under B, if you destroy, demolish a home, then you're going to put up a new home. It almost sounds like the ZBA, through just a special permit, can allow you to go into any setback, or there's no constraints on it.
If I can add to that?
Sure.
I totally agree with your interpretation. I would augment that this is, if we wanted to use some elements in this zoning update, and we're not going to do it because Zach is not ready to do it, but if we wanted in the future to use some elements of preservation practices, this 6.3.10b is going to run against them. Basically, if we could tell people that by preserving your home and upgrading it or working with it and modifying it is okay. But it's not okay to take it down and extend the nonconformity with a new structure by right, then I think we're heading in the wrong direction. I have spoken my mind in design that, you know, current building techniques are far different than what they're in the past, and we run the risk of seeing alterations in our building fabric, the way construction could go these days. So,
I don't understand her.
What it says here is that a special permit shall be required from the Board of Appeals prior to such demolition.
Well, what it says specifically at the beginning of the paragraph, it says you have to get a permit before the demolition. Step one. This says that if your proposed reconstruction is out of line, then you've got to get a special permit for the reconstruction before you do the demo.
Which is probably common sense, right? Who would demo a house if they don't know they're going to secure the footprint of a new structure?
Oh, it happens.
I know, but that doesn't mean it's not common sense.
Yeah.
It may be opportunistic, it may be risky, but it can be the norm.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure.
It's the last line, which says will be substantially more detrimental than the existing non-conforming structure to the neighborhood. That could be a little bit more defined, what that means.
Substantially more detrimental?
Well, if these are the criteria, I mean, if people, again, are trying to redefine what the new structure is, and they are, you know, they have a contractor or their architect that are looking at options, perhaps there are other criteria that can be helped to bring that new structure forward without necessarily looking at a strict interpretation of what was there, what is allowed, and basically what would go with that. I suspect this is an article that is discussed a lot during non-conforming, either at the ZBA or before cases arrive at ZBA. What are the options of the property owner once a demolition is in discussion? You know. In the private world.
Do you want to bring this back to the ZAC?
We can
talk to
Dave
Treniello specifically about that.
That's a good idea.
Tony, your concern here was that this gives a little bit too much
latitude?
Too much control
to
ZBA that...
I think Mr. Tuttle had it correct. I think it gives them too much latitude, where if you have a non-conforming structure and you want to build an even bigger non-conforming structure, all you have to be willing to do is tear down the first one. There's no requirement for a variance. It says that the Zoning Board of Appeals, just through a special permit, can do it. And
But you have to demonstrate to their satisfaction that it is not substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood.
Which is a lower bar than the requirements for a variance.
All right, we don't have to solve this now, but we can bring this back. This bullet, or this item, we'll talk through with.
That one section, that one clause, right? I mean, that is a huge, a clause that causes a lot of discussion and angst when it comes to change in people's neighborhoods. of teardowns and rebuild, and those were all the stuff across from Blueberry Lane. And I mean, there's a lot of stuff that happens related to that one particular clause. So that's an important one.
Yeah, except that 634 says a variance from the Board of Appeals is required for any reconstruction, extension, or structural change of a non-conforming structure.
I mean, it was total, but 6310 says shall be in conformance with this zoning bylaw except in the following circumstances, which I would interpret to say that this circumvents 634 or override 634.
And the difference is the demolition aspect.
Right.
That you're demolishing a pre-existing condition.
All right.
So,
yeah, okay.
Good feedback. Yeah, take that back and. Revise accordingly. Is
that whatever. I'm just getting fed up with the people gaming the system in this particular.
Absolutely. People do game this, especially this. And that's why this particular area needs to be tight. I'm not saying that it's not, but.
All right. Good.
Kill the lawyers first.
Yeah.
Thank you for that feedback, George and Tony. It's helpful.
Thank you for letting me hear me.
Sure. So I think that wraps up our update on the comprehensive update to the zoning bylaw. And we'll move on to the next agenda item, planning updates and other business. So we got the temporary library space and then the minutes from our last meeting.
I had a couple of other quick updates just to keep the board aware of what is going on. Tomorrow night specifically, we're going to be talking about the results from Professor Barry Bluestone from the Dukakis Center, Northeastern University, the EDSET. This is the self-assessment, economic development self-assessment. So that's scheduled for, the zoning is scheduled for 7:50. Maybe earlier than that. So if anyone's interested in hearing about the zoning, that'll be probably want to get there before them. But then right after that, we're going to do the EDSET, which is scheduled for 8:30. So that's what's happening tomorrow night. July 29th, we're going to be coming back to the bike and pedestrian plan, the complete streets, the South Main Street diet. So that's what's going on in the next couple of Board of Selectmen meetings, if anyone's interested. And a couple of other just quick updates, new businesses downtown. The Pilates studio that's on Woburn Street is moving to the MF Charles building. That's the rear space behind D'Amici's. You may not even be aware that there's a small space back there. But they're moving in there. Bonaratti Tavern is, they had a construction issue that I won't bore you with the details, but it was something going back to the original renovation to the building. So they've figured that out, and the issue was not applicable, so they're okay. Had to do with some insulation and R values. So the architect has basically presented an affidavit, or will be presenting an affidavit, to document how to basically get over that or exempt that issue. So, but that's been offline for a couple of weeks, and that's why. And the Hitching Post is moving into Sense of Wonder. I'm assuming everybody's aware of that. So that's kind of big news. You know, disappointing that the Hitching Post couldn't work it out to move back into the MF Charles building, and she's been sort of accommodated very nicely by the Chocolate Truffle in a small space in her store. So now, even though sadly
Sense of Wonder is leaving is they're going to consolidate everything to the Andover store. It's bad news for that, but good news that Hitching Post is going in. And there are a bunch of grants that we're working on. The cultural grant, where we've got a meeting on July 22nd. This is a small grant that we got from the state to kind of think about a cultural district or some sort of cultural component of the downtown, and sort of combining that and maybe forming some sort of group, downtown organization type of thing around culture. We also got some money to write an economic development plan. And it's interesting, a couple of the things that came out of the EDSAT, one was permitting and the other was economic development planning. And those are two of the things that, obviously with the zoning rewrite, the permitting process is going to be much more streamlined. And likewise with an economic development plan that we're going to do under this grant, that will help us improve a bit too on our economic development efforts. So, and we also got some money for a Civil War grant that was to repair some of the headstones of, I think it was 8 Civil War veterans that we have here in Reading. And so that's kind of a big project as well. Small project, but big impact.
Yeah.
We're still working with our regional group on the affordable housing and monitoring and that kind of thing. More to follow on that. And Johnson Woods, 39 Taylor, that's one of the first of the multi-unit buildings in phase two. We've issued the CFO for the first and the second floors. So those are moving right along. That's it.
I wanted to get the board's input or thoughts real quick on the sign application that will relate to the Pilates studio. I'm not sure if any of you can actually recall the sign she currently has. It's on the back of the building facing the parking lot. It's a rather large sign. It says Pilates on it.
Do we have an image?
No, we don't have an image.
This is on the, she's on the back of the
Oak Tree building?
Where Jamie Mon's property would be.
Yes.
In the rear.
Oh,
there's
okay.
Like new.
You come down the driveway and it's,
if you
a,
would look
it's
behind,
look behind you.
You.
Yeah.
So she wants, she's preferring to keep that sign, which doesn't match up to the master signage plan for the MF Charles building.
In terms of size?
Well, the MF Charles building master signage plan, we had individually applied letters for the sign faces. That was pretty specific.
What's the, what, which facade of the building will it be?
The rear facade.
Would it fit from a size standpoint?
I asked her that. I said, you know, that might be a little awkward. She's got to look into it. But I said that she can come to the board if she needs to deviate from the plan and request a certificate of appropriateness. But it would look substantially different than any other signage on the building.
Well,
I can pull
the,
up the image. Just give me 1 second.
The rear facade or the rear entry for Northern Bank has got the individual letters.
On the canopy.
On the canopy, yeah.
Correct.
I mean, I'm not sure, it's, if you're looking at that portion of the building, you're not looking at any part of either Main or Haven Street, so. You know, I'm not sure how much consistency is a concern.
What's the master signage plan? What about the next tenant?
You think she should come
True.
Before us?
Well, she w-
no,
if
she have to.
If she does not comply with the master signage plan, she will have to.
Right, that's what I mean.
Yeah. So I just wanted, you know, I told her I was, you know, this is a unique building. We have very specific details for the building.
Mm.
Her sign is a big sign.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know how that fits in the space.
No,
I asked.
I know.
First thing we're going to do is stick that sign.
That ugly. No.
Well,
because it's right, the space, any space there is long and.
Yeah.
It's meant for like a 2x8.
Yeah.
More of a, like a 2x8.
That won't work.
Yeah.
Size.
No.
So,
So, I mean, so, I would tell her that she can come before us to
argue
it, but we're probably not going to agree on what
wouldn't
she's proposing.
Wouldn't most of her clients, it's in the back of the building. Don't they already know she's there? I mean, how important is having
a big...
Well,
she also wanted to do a blade sign on the main, by Bunratty, by Main and the alleyway, and I said
I don't think
we allowed that.
No.
It wasn't in the drawings, and I checked the other document.
That would be kind of nice, I think, but not this sign.
So.
Yeah.
It would be nice to have visibility.
Yeah,
I don't know how you get there.
Completely opposed to something that provides whoever her or whoever's back there some better visibility.
Yeah.
But putting up a sign that's shaped this wrong.
What's the address? Is the back of the building have its own address?
628. It's 628 Main.
We're gonna approach it from the parking lot. They're not gonna park on Main Street. Well, I guess a few people might park on Main Street and walk through the alley to get back there, but they'll know it's there. For the most part, I think people will try to park in the lot and just approach it.
She has no visibility on Woburn Street. This is the only sign she has.
Hmm.
And she is allowed a blade sign, but it stipulates in front of their storefront. So, and that storefront ends. Bunratty has the other rear portion from front to back. But if she wants to propose it as part of her submission to this board, she could.
If there's a personally, if there's a rational place for her to put her blade sign where she could have a different set of visibility, it seems to make sense to me. Whether it's her, there may be someone else that uses that space in the future that needs more, a little more visibility than
like
she.
Like back corner. With an arrow pointing around or something?
Or maybe it's something in the alley, some sort of attractive, you know, because there's not more than her back there. There's Agnes and there's Rough and Ready and, you know, there's three or four businesses that have no frontage at all.
That'd be interesting. I'd be open to something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And where I think the alley, we would have our own ability to do something.
Maybe, maybe there's... something from the building facade and
maybe it's a wayfinding
program.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like a directory almost.
Yeah.
Yeah. Freestanding, almost wayfinding.
Well, we could do it as a blade sign on a post.
I don't know if if they had any extra.
In the alleyway.
Yeah, I mean, I'd have to walk it to see exactly what I'm thinking about, but if there are several businesses there, that's not a bad way to get people from Main Street to see that, because that alleyway is going to be ignited once that restaurant opens up. When people get used to seeing activity there, they'll always be looking down that way.
Are you talking about the courtyard?
The courtyard.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was talking about the alley where the other businesses are, too.
Well, there's nothing you can do, but that's too narrow to do anything that's visible from not from from a car or from a further away than just the immediate pedestrian entrance.
Mm.
Unless you put it on the building, but now you're talking about a remote sign.
Yeah.
Well, that's why I said, I mean, the wayfinding, which is the town has the right to.
In our own town-owned area, we can accommodate.
Yeah, we could.
All right. Anything to mention about the library space?
Yeah, so obviously they're going into One General Way, and we had suggested that they come before this board at the next meeting, the 29th. And so we would want to notice the neighborhood and get the word out. But we wanted to also just put it out there. You know, there isn't a whole lot, I don't think, for anybody to review for a minor site plan review for the space. But when we talked about it, we said any of the bigger spaces, like SOLA and whatever, would come back to CPDC. What you're really going to be reviewing is signs and book drop, and maybe take another look at the parking lot.
We didn't look at a whole lot with solar.
No.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's fine.
Well, we're looking, I mean, at some point we want to see that the parking refit, you know, rearrangement has been done as the, according to the plan of record.
Yeah.
Yeah, but they're not there yet.
No, they're not.
But this says that the speed table has been put in. I haven't been over there recently enough to see it.
It's there.
Yeah.
It's not very noticeable, but.
And right, they were supposed to give you sort of a recounting of parking as, I forget.
Upon the occupation of a certain amount of retail space.
Yep.
Yeah. We're not there yet, but if we would consider the library retail space, that might get triggered.
I would assume the library is retail space.
Yeah.
I mean, what else is it? If it was a bookstore, I mean,
yep.
Institutional.
Okay. Anything else on?
That's it.
All right. Want to knock out these minutes?
Sure.
I reviewed them. I think Nick, you sent comments.
Thanks, John.
In your packet, page 35 reflects Nick's comments that he gave me earlier today.
It was 20 foot plus the
Parking.
Parking.
Right.
Okay.
Which is the 8 foot width. So yeah, the total of 28.
If the 20 was 24 plus the parking, or if it was
no,
20.
It was 20 plus the parking,
so then,
plus the sidewalk.
So then that just stays the way it is.
Right. Yeah. Move that CPC approve the minutes for the meeting of June 23rd, 2014, as amended.
Second.
All those in favor? Another motion?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?